welcome to the November 30th meeting of the Community Preservation Committee. As always, we begin with public comment. There is no public to comment. I didn't go on my email. Did the minutes come through?
I did not do.
Okay, so no minutes. The chair's report, so two items in the paper that you may have noticed, those of you who get the Gazette, the Gazette. One was yesterday, Sarah helped me out if I misspeak, the $2.5 million that came in for the Pleasant Street improvement projects, which really helped facilitate two of our big affordable housing projects there on Pleasant Street, on both sides of the street. So I think that was really good news. It doesn't go directly, any of it, right, to affordable housing, but it does create that infrastructure to support the street and some of those big projects.
From, I was out of town. It came in from where?
From the state. It's worth $2.5 million.
Yeah. Is it not DOT money?
No.
It's not MassWorks.
MassWorks.
Yeah, so that's
economic development, I think.
Okay.
And that was the front page of yesterday's paper. The front page of today's paper was the land grants that came in for Amherst, Belchertown, and then Northampton. So we did receive the Birds, Bog, and Turtles land grant. We did not receive the one that we were waiting on, which was the Mineral Hills one. So that one did come through, the one did not, so that will help us in our deliberations this evening. The third thing I wanted to mention is I think most of us, perhaps all of us, got the email from Wayne regarding donations to open space acquisition stuff. So just a reminder, those of us looking for that perfect holiday gift for that special someone who is everything, maybe a donation in their name would be nice. And he gave two options for giving, right? Mm-hmm. One was through the community fund and one was just directly to the city.
I actually didn't get that, even though I have given Lando money for Lando.
Huh. Yeah. Well, you'd think you'd be first on the list to get that. Then, Sarah, can you send that on?
Sure,
if
you can do that.
That would be great.
Yeah, I didn't get that on.
Really? Mm-hmm. Oh, goodness. That's so maybe if you resend that out to all of us, that would be nice. Tonight's our big night. Hopefully we will power through and make funding recommendations for all 2, 4, 6, 8 of these projects. To reiterate, we went through 6 of them 2 weeks ago on Wednesday night. We left the Mineral Hills acquisition. It did not discuss that, given the fact that we're waiting for the land grant and we're sort of out of time. And we also didn't discuss the conservation fund. So my suggestion is that we begin tonight with the Mineral Hills project and open up discussion on that. Then we do a quick little tally in our shopping cart and then perhaps go then to the conservation fund, which will, knowing what we have in the shopping cart will help us to determine what, if any, we want to give to the conservation fund. The hope is we'll go back and not have to have that much discussion on each project. I think we do need to deal with some of the conditions, particularly the bogs and turtles. We wanted to further open that up to discussion on conditions. We had a pretty significant one in the Hampshire County Courthouse, and I'm not sure we had real conditions on anything else that was there, but we'll just make sure before we vote that we know what we're voting on, which is not just money, but conditions that we have set for. So first would be the Mineral Hills, then we do a quick tally of where we are, and then look at CONSCOM, and then look at conditions for everything else, and then vote. Does that make sense for folks? Yes? Okay, so as always, we're still in our shopping cart. These are formal motions. They don't mean we're actually voting. But can someone make a motion regarding the Mineral Hills Barnes Aquifer Open Space Acquisition?
I move to fund it
$266,500.
It seems to have been reduced in this email.
Oh, correct. What?
$240,000. So I would move to fund it at $240,000.
Thank you for reminding us. So it's not $266,500, it is $240,000. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, discussion.
So clarifying, there was some funding that was applied for, a grant that was applied for and didn't come through on this Mineral Hills. Does that affect the purchase?
So the funding request was originally for $265,000. They would have reduced the request to $106,000 had the land grant been successful. So the assumption is now the $240,000 is what the ask is rather than the lower ask. Is that correct, Sarah?
Yes, so the non-land amount is reduced a little bit because Wayne was able to come up with some additional CDBG funding for the affordable housing portion.
Other discussion?
I really liked, and I don't know if you know, Sarah, Wayne's email seems to be saying, unlike any other times, we're not proposing putting any of these acquisitions off because they're important and at the low market value and we may never see them again. But that's kind of a blanket statement about all of them.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if you know anything more about Glendale Road and how likely that is to be lost.
The option would definitely have to be extended. I'm not sure if it's something that the property owner would be willing to do.
Do you know anything about what's motivating the property owner?
I believe it was a partnership of developers, and one of them died fairly recently. So the one that was remaining was considering his options. And this seemed like a good one for him at the time that we began discussions.
So there's a good chance if in fact we did not act on this, we would lose this parcel. Is that correct, sir?
It's a possibility. I can't say sure either way, and I don't think we could either.
Jack, do you want to speak to this from the Towns Council?
Well, yeah, I think we went over, it was covered fairly well by Wayne when he was here, that it connects to another piece of property in that Mineral Hills chain that we're attempting to put together, and the fact that it is allowing us to spin off some affordable housing on Glendale Road and access, pretty good access point to it. But I think that the fact that it's connected to, or potentially in the future connected to the Mineral Hills parcels is the significance of it, creating those corridors.
And Wayne's preference would definitely be to allocate all of the funding to this project to make it work no matter what, but that would come at the cost of some of these other projects on the page for sure.
He'd prefer this one to the Fox and Turtles?
Not to Fox and Turtles.
Okay, just checking.
So assuming that one's funded, he would prefer it to these other acquisitions that are listed, just because it's so far along and includes the affordable housing component as well.
He would prefer it to the Broadbrook to Beaverbrook acquisition?
I mean, I believe he was assuming, based on the shopping cart, that would be funded also. I don't know where he would put the two of them in priority if they were weighed against each other.
So the issue that we're up against is if we spend $240,000, we are really limiting ourselves for the next round. If we don't, we're in danger of losing this parcel. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
Along that line, we deferred on two things last week, last meeting. One was the Mineral Hills. The other was the conservation funding. And in Wayne's email today, yesterday, when I got this afternoon. Wayne has proposed spending the full $80,000 yet to be allocated in the conservation money on three projects that I don't know anything about. So what we're really looking at, if we fund the things that we have already sort of tacitly agreed to and Mineral Hills, is a possible complete allocation for land acquisition of right in the ballpark of $600,000, which I think would pretty much preclude us doing, and I would have to look at it more closely, but I don't think that that leaves us really any room at all for another round.
I think the question of whether there is a good reason to be another round, whether we want another round, is an important first step to knowing whether or not you're actually going to do this or not. I know it's an on the one hand, but on the other hand kind of thing, but, and I haven't been involved with this before. I have no idea what's apt to come up. I know that if you only have $40,000 there, if that's what it might end up with, it's practically nothing in terms of substance. There's always something that's going to be lost one way or the other, and I have no idea what the import of carrying money over and always having a second round is, and I don't know the rest of you who've been doing this for a while feel about that.
Well, we have always carried money over, and there have always been projects. So no doubt, if we don't spend down, there'll be other projects that will come before us that we think are worth it. On the other hand, we will have waited for lovely projects, and which we speculate are going to come, okay. while we watch the development of the commercial development of green spaces that we can't take back. So that seems like it's a fairly straightforward decision to me that we need to save what we need to act now and spend down. If we value the preservation of green spaces in the city, and certainly many of us do, then and if we feel like we have been responsible in other regards, then I think, and certainly we have, as far as housing goes, very responsible. It would feel very odd to me to be turning down time-sensitive projects because we might get something in the future. We won't, this way, what we'll do if we get those nice projects is say, hold on, we're going to get more money next June, and we'll take care of it in the fall.
So we're saying that conservation, which I understand the question of what gets built and what doesn't get built, conservation can't necessarily be held up. But what we're saying is conservation is the most critical of the variable things that we find.
We don't necessarily have to, it's not Sophie's choice, we don't have to, give up other ideas, but we say right now these are the most time sensitive projects. If we were in the same situation and there was some major problem with Ford's library, it'd be totally redone again, we might say, okay, we're going to give a lion's share to preservation this round.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get that kind of thought out in the open so that I hear what other people think. What about the other people?
I'd like to make a proposal. If we do, discuss this and decide that we want to go ahead with all these conservation purchases, and we have maybe $50,000 left in the pot, maybe we could do a spring round that was just small grants. We could have a special small grant cycle in the spring, just one-time thing. But we could invite more small grant proposals. Might be an interesting round to do.
So And I want to make sure that the meetings would be stretched out and last just as long as we would not be going without.
Sarah, have you heard about, I mean, we're dealing with unknowables here. Obviously, purchasing the land now would be a sure thing, putting it off introduces some uncertainty, but we don't really know how much uncertainty. So we're never going to get the amount of knowledge that we want to make the best possible decision. So I'm looking for just a little bit more knowledge. Have you heard anything about other projects that would be intended to come in? Have you got inquiries?
The only one that I've heard so far is Valley CDC. They're planning renovations to an SRO house that they have on Bridge Street. So that's either going to be next round or the following round. And if some of these open space acquisitions are held, I would imagine Ray would probably come back again. But that's the only other one.
Sarah, can you do the math for us real quick, or do you have it, what our shopping cart currently contains? Do you have that?
Yeah.
Suffice to say, Mr. Amazon would be getting free shipping.
Right now it's $497,647.
And we'd have to put aside a little bit in reserve for the SARC, right? But we won't have fully spent our 10%.
Now they are at, with the shopping cart, it's $116,000. And the reserve is
And sir, what is 881,582 minus 497,000?
Off the top of
your head.
Where's Dustin Hoffman?
That's right.
Now, with the shopping cart so far, the remainder is $383,935.
Does that include the $80,000 that's on this thing Wayne sent us?
No. Sorry, say it again, $383,935.
And that, so Chris, that's only what the committee is voting on so far. Right.
So that doesn't include the $240,000 either?
No.
Correct.
Yeah. So we put that in, we have $63,935, of which $34,000 is reserved for STAR.
For what?
The STAR.
So we're about spent out. We're really close. I mean, it's so if we have 383, let's just do the math one more time for my thick skull. We have 380, let's call it $4,000 left in our shopping cart. If we fully funded, 240 plus 80 is 320. So that's 63,000 left. We have to put 34,000 in historic preservation.
So, and that would also require the committee to spend the affordable housing reserve on the first fund.
Correct. Which would be one of the conditions that we would put forward. So essentially we would have, So further discussion on this.
Are we all bonded out?
We are not.
It seems, I mean, I'm a new person, but it seems to me that the bond payments we have to make right now are really limit us.
We have about, my recollection is we have about 200,000, and I believe it's 212,000 in bond capacity.
And it's 200,000 bonded?
No, we have a capacity to take on bonding worth roughly 212,000. That's from memory.
Yeah.
It's right up there. I think you got.
And this is a little. You never want to get
222.
You got to go by the 176 figure though, because that's when something else kicks in.
Oh right, the low. You're right. Yep. Good call. Thank you.
What
that doesn't, and my recollection also is that that does not include bonding for phase two.
I think FY18.
No. So that kick. That's why the amount goes down. So that this lower number is when the that what we estimate.
Okay, that's where we see phase two.
What more information do we need from Sarah or from each other to go ahead with the Mineral Hills proposal? Question. Julia said anything? Is there anything?
I don't have anything to add. I agree with everything that's been said. Park choice. Let's make it. If we could get more information, it would be, tell us what's going to happen in the spring. We'd like to know.
I would just point out that Bridge Street Valley does currently own it, so it's not like they need it in order to secure
It's an SRO, and they're planning an enhanced SRO, and they're going to
expand it
as well.
Would it hurt their project if they needed to come to us in the fall as opposed to the spring?
I don't really know that how far along they are in it. They usually like CPA funds up front early, but I don't think it's, you may know differently, Sarah. I don't think they've gotten very far in the development of that.
They just called today, actually, to ask about the schedule for the upcoming round. So it would be a portion historic preservation and a portion affordable housing. David, this is the same house that came to the historic commission.
Mm-hmm. Sarah, if aggressive private fundraising happened, and Wayne's email went out to lots of receptive ears, is there a possibility that would lower any of these expenditures?
I think the donations and other grants column is what Wayne realistically thinks he can raise for each of these projects. Okay. And there's always a possibility that more could come in.
He's saying, Brian, in his email that he did send, that they're doing a more aggressive match than ever before, and we'll need to call in every donor and grant resource to make this happen. So I don't think. I think that's wishful thinking. I'm not
going to
be that much.
Just saying. Well, Linda, it's up to you.
22, right on
it's
you.
It's all on you.
Yeah.
Okay, further discussion on the Mineral Hills Barnes Aquifer. So the motion on the table, once again, this is for our shopping cart, is for $240,000 to be allocated to that project. All those in favor? All those opposed? That is 7-1. Okay, thank you. Moving on then to the Conservation Commission Conservation Fund. Is there a motion on the table?
$580,000.
Second?
Second.
Discussion?
What's the amount again?
80.
Chris?
My understanding of the way this pot of money is to work is to set aside some resources for unanticipated eventualities. And I see the exact opposite here. I see specific allocations for projects that were not submitted via the normal process and that exceed the cap for small grants. What we will do if we do it this way without putting conditions on the money, and I don't think we can say, but you can't spend it on the three projects you proposed, is basically fund three new projects and not leave the planning office with any flexibility for upcoming unanticipated eventualities. So I'm going to vote against this one.
Sarah, my understanding was that hard costs over $20,000 only with the approval of us. Yet these three projects that we're looking at being funded Conservation Commission Conservation Fund all exceed $20,000.
That's the way the CPC had always set it up previously. That's a condition that could change if the committee so decided to.
Okay. So
the amount could be raised or lowered, or additional conditions placed on the grant award. But that's been typical, I think, in the past 6 or 7 conservation funds.
So I think Chris's point is an important one. This will be the first time that we are funding tangible land acquisition projects with this 80,000. Essentially, it's like Wayne's coming to us with 3 more acquisition projects rather than using the 80,000 to do or whatever.
Well, I'm taking a stance on this because I'm going to benefit from this discussion. But if we give him, if we were to give him money so that the projects came up, and he should use it wisely, and then during the year he spent that 80,000 on 3 projects, would we be happy? Because that's sort of what the intention was. Whereas this way, we're given the same amount of money, the 3 projects are there, and he's spending them right away. It's sort of the same thing, it seems to me.
The effect may be the same, but I'm wondering why he didn't. I'm sorry, I wanted to respond.
Oh, you're already there.
I'm wondering why he chose to do it this way and and not, because we don't know anything about these particular parcels. Perhaps Jack does, but I don't want to put you on the spot unless you. So it just seems a little odd to me. The end result will probably be the same, but it does kind of take our ability to look at the merits away.
My understanding of the need for this money and the urgency of the money is that sometimes work needs to be done before the city even makes a move on the property. You know, there are negotiations, there may be surveys, there may be consultants, there may be boundary things that have to be surveyed. There's some upfront costs before it even gets to the proposal stage. That if you don't have access to the money, or that if you have to go and ask for the funds, that's going to take another cycle, and the opportunity is going to pass. The landowner won't wait 6 months to find out if they have $3,000 to do the survey to maybe offer him some amount of money. So that's what I always understood this fund to be, is access to money to make things happen on a timely fashion for the seller to be confident that we're actually serious about our intent for conservation land.
Let me ask you a question. I think you're absolutely right. I think that we're all in agreement in a sense. If Wayne were to hamstring himself by immediately spending this money, as he's proposing, what harm would that be? Are there?
Well,
you miss out on projects that
eliminate opportunities coming down. I mean, he has to use it wisely because, you know, there are maybe other parcels that the office has their eye on that are close to negotiation that this fund would be critical to.
That's the same argument as the other. I mean, I have to agree with your points, and I'm really struggling, you know, as I look at these numbers, seeing that $210,000 that we don't know about is coming from donations and other grants. What grants? You know, what does that final column mean? We're not the biggest contributor to this if we're contributing $80,000, but these are 3 projects that it seems have been in the planning for longer than just this week. Here's a last minute email I'm going to get to you about 3 projects that crossed my desk today. And they really are projects. They are not, it crossed my desk today. If there are donations and other grants that are being lined up.
The cumulative value of these projects are 65 plus 92 plus 133. I can't do the math, but it's over 200K.
Oh, yeah, right. And if you go, and what I do is I went to that other, you know, I go to that other end, right. And I'm looking at where else is he getting the money from?
Sarah, can you enlighten us at all about these 3 parcels? It seems like there's an option in place on them.
There's an option on all of them. So which
the three that he is proposing to immediately spend the $80,000 on.
Corza, Williams, and Pierce.
Thank you. Corza, which is Coles Meadow, Robert Ridgway, Williams, which is Water Street at Sawmill, Roberts Hill, and then Pierce property on Route 66 in Mineral Hills.
Jeff, you going to say something?
I'm wondering what, I agree with pretty much everything else that's been said, but one of the past meetings somebody remarked that when it comes to funding this, the amount requested is always on the high end, and the amount that's funded is never what the requested amount is. So I wonder how much it takes for the possible survey and other information gathering without getting into the business of funding something that somebody said we don't really know much about these the way we do these other eight items that we've already acted upon. And I also think that as far as the land, I think so far were we to give what we've done so far a final vote and pass it, I think we've already gone above and beyond conservation land acquisition. And we basically severely limited whatever options we might have in the next round already. Mm-hmm. And I just don't see that we need to fund this $80,000 amount requested. I will not support that.
Chris?
I just want to address Dave's point, which was that, as I understand it, you know, if we were to allocate $80,000 and Wayne was to come back in a year and say, these are the three projects on which I spent it, what would be the difference? And I think from a functional standpoint, there would be no difference, but I don't like the feeling that an end around is being done. And that is distinctly the way it feels to me. I could be completely wrong, and you know, but I just, it walks like a duck to me.
But how else would he deal with, how else would he make these offers and get these options on this conservation land if he didn't have it?
It's a fair point, Jack, and maybe I'm being hypersensitive. I get that, but Wayne was here with his other proposals, you know, two meetings ago, and as I understand it, these $200,000 worth of projects were not on his list.
They were still being negotiated.
So Sarah, these are these that new? As in like the last few weeks since?
Some of them are just out of executive session stage, quickly.
The three that we're looking at?
So let's see, so Randall. So which ones are we carrying? So Corza it's in the top right, it's on the half line.
Actually walk that land, it's very nice.
Mm-hmm. Jack, my question is, thinking in terms of scaling this, are there any pieces of these three that are particularly special or jeopardized or et cetera, et cetera?
I really don't know, because I haven't been privy to any of the negotiations with the landowners.
Fair enough.
But we did know going into this that this is an extremely unusual period of time when, you know, like the door was opening up on these negotiations and these parcels. We've never had this much conservation land being available in key spots. This is just an unusual stretch of time. The office has been very busy, I'm sure, because this is an unusual circumstance. The last 2 years have been really remarkable in that respect.
Yeah, and to reiterate that in my time on the committee, never has something like this come up. Mm-hmm. We've had all of these conservation properties and that we've been faced with spending all of our money in one half-year period. So it is, for those folks who are new, this is very unique for us.
May I add, just from a longevity standpoint, when we have been faced with some very, very large requests in the past that would have emptied our coffers had we not bought it. And since there are so many, they tend to be singular projects, like Forbes or something, or the Allard fields and playgrounds and sports fields and so on. So they had an ending, whereas these are disparate pieces of land. But I suppose we could kick around the notion of not emptying our treasury and bonding this group of projects if they really do constitute such an unusual opportunity, and if they're likely to otherwise slip through the city's hands.
I would actually be more concerned about emptying out our bonding capacity than emptying out a particular round.
Yeah, okay. I agree with that.
Other discussion on the cons cut?
Are you coming up with any more information there, or no? You plumb the depths here.
What information?
Well, knowing anything about, I mean, I think there's a process discomfort. I do know that the core is a property, and I think it has some very rich habitat there, particularly for bears.
I can point to them, but I don't have a tremendous amount of them.
But I share the sense that we're being asked to make a decision without a whole lot of information and kind of subverting the process. So I'm torn between the value of the project and wanting to protect the process. So I'm looking for something to make me feel better about funding it.
Yeah, we would have all felt better if Wayne hadn't been honest. If he hadn't said, you know, this is where if you fully fund the conservation fund, this is where I intend to put that money. And if you just said, fully fund the conservation fund, it goes over $20,000 on costs, I'll come back to you and tell you what I might be looking for. And so a week later, we'd be meeting again and say, here's what I'm not doing.
Right.
So, this is honesty.
There is this way in that question and answer thing that he did. For the questions, he does hint at two parcels without getting into specifics, and I'm assuming that those are two of the three that are here, but I don't really know. And he said it, I don't want to name them because it's still in flux, mm-hmm. it's still in the works,
right.
But here's
that's
where
right.
we're kind of going for. But I still think we don't know enough about it.
Yeah.
We have, particularly for new folks, we have an expedited request, a process through which proposals can come to us if, in fact, there is a sense of urgency. And we could act on those in our first meetings when we get back together in January.
You mean those three? Is that what you're talking about?
Well, I'm saying that folks can come to us and say, we need to act on this right now. And we cannot wait for May when we would be giving recommendations to City Council.
But doesn't he have to come to us for approval? Even if we funded the $80,000, wouldn't he still have to come to us for approval?
Well, we could make conditions that would say that if these three proposals are fine. We can do whatever we want. We're the CPC.
Right, but I'm just saying, he put it into the project summary himself. Because that's traditionally what's been done with the fund.
Right.
It says,
yes.
Hard costs under $20,000 per project and hard costs over $20,000 with the approval of the CPC.
So really, as you said, Julia, he's being very honest.
Right.
I mean, this is three parcels that we're funding rather than going into the conservation fund. It's a different, it's different than the proposal. It's a different request.
I get that, but we could still stick to this request, mm-hmm. And then he has to come back to us, and then we can actually get what we want, which is give us more information about Corza, Williams, and Fierce, because they're all over 20,000. Then we get all the information, and that's that then sits at our approval or not.
Unless he goes and funds these three projects at 20,000 apiece.
Yes.
And then
and gets even more donations
and
other grants.
And moves around donations, which is entirely possible.
Well, or we could just specify them and say we want more information. Will we approve the use of these funds for Corza Williams?
Does how that money gets spent usually come in amounts as much as $20,000, or is it more bits and pieces?
More bits and pieces.
That's what I thought from what he was saying before, that this amount wasn't the way I anticipated that fund being spent, but rather in the $5,000 and $6,000 things that you don't know where you're going to get it from, because that's not the way you budget stuff, and here are these bits and pieces.
And if you look at the back, if you have a proposal in front of you, if you look at the back, he gives us what some of the recent funding has been.
Yeah.
And you know, as little as $979, $275, $1,600.
Yeah.
There have been ones, $17,000, $7,000. So, you know, there's been a lot up there, but.
But not just three pieces in this kind of a fashion at that amount of money.
I think this is unique, is it not, Sarah?
Yeah, so when Wayne's invoices, just when everybody's invoices, like go through the applications and make sure that the expenses are in accordance with what was actually awarded, and he's never submitted a hard cost that's over 20,000, so he's never had to come back to that.
Well, I kind of like that fund for that kind of purpose myself. I don't know what that means, having not been involved too much, but it seems to me that bits and pieces are sometimes really hard to deal with. And
yeah, I do too, but the bits and pieces are supposed to lead to a prize, which is the land, so here's a prize.
I understand, I do.
Mm-hmm. I kind of like going along the lines of what Julie was suggesting, which is to fund the 80,000. To tell him that we anticipate that he's going to use it for these three, but that he's got to come in specific and get specific approval on all those, on each of those. And if not, then it's going to go to it.
Something else.
So the condition, Linda, would remain the same, that hard costs under 20,000 is fine, but 20,000 above, he needs approval. So Wayne would have to come back to us for the 3,000 for one.
Well, we could lower the amount. I don't want to start suspecting an end run here, but if we were to lower the amount to say, 10,000, then he almost certainly would have to come to us if he intends to use it for these partials.
Who made the motion for the 80,000? Was that you?
It was I.
Is there a condition you'd like to attach to that then? I mean, I'm wondering if we should vote on the monetary proposal, or if we should be attaching conditions to it as we vote on it.
Well, we can try with conditions and see if that meets with any favor, and then we can propose something modified if it doesn't. So I would propose the $80,000 with the condition that any hard cost expenditures in excess of $10,000 have to come back to the committee for approval.
Is there a second for that?
Second.
We sort of subverted the process a little because there was a motion on the floor for $80,000.
But I amended my own.
You amended your motion. Okay. So the current motion, everyone got that? $80,000 with $10,000, over $10,000 for hard costs. Coming back to us, which in this case would mean, I'm assuming, the end of January. We're not meeting in 2 weeks, right?
We could
meet in 2 weeks. Okay, if in fact you want to come back. So we may just be revisiting this again.
Well, the money wouldn't, it wouldn't be available by then anyway, the city council wouldn't have voted on it.
And whenever we, what we want is information.
Yeah.
And so we get it, that, you know, we.
That's a way to get the information.
Right.
Chris, your thoughts on that?
I'm good.
Anybody else want to speak to that? Jack from ConsCom, is that?
Yeah, that's, like you said, it's a good way to get information. There's some that I'm not privy to either, but I understand the need for, you know, a fund to draw for mostly soft costs.
Okay.
And beyond information, actually, the second thing is we'd also be able to relay a message.
Process.
And hi, we're really uncomfortable about this. This approach.
Further?
We'll relay that message, right?
Yeah.
No, absolutely.
Further discussion on this? Okay, everybody clear what we're voting on? 80,000 with the condition that hard costs would have to be less than $10,000, unless they had the approval of the Community Preservation Committee. That's the only condition that we would attach to this, is that correct? Are we ready to vote? Yes? Okay. All those in favor? All those opposed? I'm sorry, Jeff, did your hand go up on that?
No, I was going to abstain.
Okay, so that's a 7-2 with one abstention. All right, so once again, Sarah, can you add that up for us? Sorry. The 497,647 plus the 240 plus the 80 gives us what again?
Now we are up to, including the historic Northampton awards, $817,647.
Yes. Okay. Is currently in our shopping cart. Okay. All right, so as it stands now, in our shopping cart is $234,700 for bogs and turtles. The acquisition, we need to go back to that in a moment and look at conditions for that. $100,000 for the Hampshire County Courthouse. Our condition was only if additional funds come through by, someone refresh my memory, September?
September 17th.
September?
30th.
30th. Okay. September 30th. That was the only condition on that. $16,947 for Beaverbrook, $90,000 for the Connecticut River Greenway, $80,000 for ConsCom Fund, $10,000 for Smith Charities, $40,000 for Broadbrook to Beaverbrook acquisition, and $240,000 for Mineral Hills.
I'm sorry, what was the figure you gave for Smith Charities?
$10,000. Is that correct, what I
yes,
said yeah. that other people had? And again, that total is $870,640, which we are able to do. Can we go back now and look at attaching conditions to, or further conditions before we begin our final round of voting on any of these? Linda, we sort of put you on the spot last, 2 weeks ago, with the affordable housing and the bogs and turtles. One, was there anything that you...
Well, we had a discussion before. The proposal was saying that it was going to be 120, the affordable housing was to be affordable to those at 120% of area median and the eligibility for community housing is 100%. So it would have to be conditioned on the affordable housing being made affordable to those that are below 100% of AMI. Yeah.
And I passed that along to Wayne after the meeting, so that was fine.
So we need to add that as a condition.
So the way the proposal reads right now is what's lots at or below 120%,
mm-hmm.
and you are suggesting we change it to a 100%.
Otherwise, it does not, it's not considered.
Yeah, it has to do that.
Okay.
We can't limit affordable housing.
Great, thank you. Is there language, sorry, can you come up with
yes.
that specific language?
We also wanted to allocate, well, we don't know how much, but we wanted to allocate at least whatever the 10%.
So about 150,000. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's going to be 150,000 from the housing set aside and 84,700 from the undesignated reserve.
And
we could do housing, it doesn't, I just made notes that would make the numbers work.
And I guess I wouldn't, he had suggested that it could be 211,000 allocated towards affordable housing, and I guess I wouldn't go up that high because it's not that much affordable housing, and I don't sort of don't want to take us off the hook by making it look like we spent a whole lot of money.
So for record, there's sort of two ways we do it. There's the actual, where are we taking the money from? And then we also keep track of the percentages for projects. So if we spend 150,000 from the affordable housing reserve, we could, on paper, allocate the rest of that.
Right.
Okay.
So that's not a condition that we put on it. It's something.
It's just the way we look at the projects.
Okay.
Going
all
forward.
Right. Great.
Okay.
So for the bogs and turtles, the two things we do is one, make sure that affordable housing is coming in for the whatever the Sarah's language is regarding the 100% AMI, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that we know that we're allocating 150 from housing and 84 from undesignated or whatever. Any other conditions on that one that we can think of?
I just don't understand how it will work if the affordable housing never gets realized. Is there some point at which we have to kind of make that up? And
the way it's set up, it will have to, or Wayne will have to give the money back. So because he's gone out to bid for the three affordable units, just as he established in the application, and for some reason those that couldn't work for whatever reason,
mm-hmm.
he would be able to draw down the funding.
So he has to have that secured in order to draw down the funding somehow?
So we would,
I guess I'm not,
yeah, I mean, I
don't quite understand.
We'd need an affordable housing restriction, the way the projects have typically been structured. Usually we don't provide the funds
right.
until closing, and the affordable housing restriction has been recorded.
So is that a condition that we can, or is that just,
That's the way it's been done, just because of the type of project.
That doesn't assure that the housing is built. That just assures that land is reserved for affordable housing.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just trying to think, you know, 5 years from now it hasn't been built. What's
yeah? But I guess that's the same for every affordable housing project. Really?
Well, except usually it's drawn down, isn't it, at the closing?
Yeah.
The closing usually has all of the funding pieces there.
Yeah. So this would be the same. So those lots would be permanently restricted to affordable housing.
Right.
They may not have the houses on them.
They won't have the houses.
No.
The important part of it.
But I guess the same could be said for a Valley CDC project.
Except they won't draw it down until they have all of the funding in hand.
Yeah.
And
but
you know, and at that point the housing is proceeding.
Yeah, but I guess it's, there's a couple different ways to look at it. Like, Hamp has drawn down their funding for the Northampton lodging property, and the building hasn't been constructed. They're closing on it, but there's nothing there. It's a vacant lot. So I guess worst case scenario, they something could happen and they wouldn't be able to finish the project, but the lot would still be restricted to affordable housing, the way that it was structured in the CPA award.
Correct.
Well, I think the difference that I see here is that this isn't an affordable housing project. It's a land acquisition project with affordable housing. And the fact that housing doesn't get built on the affordable housing lots doesn't preclude the acquisition of 115 acres of land, which is really what's going on here. And I raised this concern when we were early talking about this earlier, which is this is using affordable housing money to acquire land. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but I think, you know, we should call it what it is. And, you know, I don't see where the incentive on an affordable housing project is, it's an empty lot. Here, it's still acquired city land that has affordable housing available to it that hasn't been built. And those are two different things, in my mind.
I mean, the only other way to do it would not be to draw down the affordable housing reserve, but then something would either have to get dropped or bonded.
So I'm just I'm trying to think if there's some trigger if it should happen that the affordable housing isn't built after what would be a reasonable period of time, and I don't know how Wayne would feel about that.
Well, that's property that would be desirable, so it could always be sold. If it were sold, then the money would be given back, I assume.
Sense.
But then it's not affordable housing.
Right. Of course it isn't. But you've got your affordable housing money back.
Well, we get the 150,000.
You get your, I mean, I understand your face. I understand what you're saying. But you do get your money back. It's not like if you can't get affordable housing, it's not like you've spent that affordable housing money on something that's purpose-staying open space.
Although you'll have to get the restriction release.
That's right.
Which is no easy matter.
Well, I don't know about that, but that's true. Yeah, no, it's
absolutely intended by the city for this to be affordable housing. There's an RFP out there and things are in the works.
I'm not questioning the intent at all. I think this really is a legitimate effort to put affordable housing there. The only problem is, what if the takers? Have we lost all control over this, or is there a way to?
Is there a condition there, Linda, that you can think of that would help, or Chris, or anyone that would help us to feel better about the affordable housing component?
Well, I could see putting a time limit by which there would need to be affordable housing on it, or yes, repayment, but I just don't know what the practicalities of that are, and if that's really putting the...
Well, we have a 3-year time limit, correct, Sarah?
I think you need more than that.
Yeah, I mean, there is, but the way that affordable housing is structured, the funding has to be available at closing. And at that point, an affordable housing restriction is placed on the property. So that guarantees that forever, or 99 years lately, there will have to be affordable housing on that property. So if no one answers the RFP, and it would sit vacant, it wouldn't be able to be market rate.
Any other discussion on this? Still not hearing another condition other than the 100%.
Well, I was starting to work towards a number. I'm not quite sure I follow what you said, Sarah. The money's not going to be available for to build the housing at the point that it's drawn down.
No, it will. The money will go towards closing, as it does with every
the acquisition of the land.
Yes. Yeah.
At which point the restriction will be put on.
Yes.
So if there had to be affordable housing within 10 years, or the money paid back? Or is your argument that the opportunity for the affordable housing is the restriction?
I mean, I'm just
what
thinking,
we're buying.
Practically, how would that apply to another affordable housing project? If HAP's project stalled for some reason, the affordable housing restriction would still be in place, so they wouldn't be able to recoup their funds. And I think it's the same situation here.
Well, you need to get a release of the restriction and go through the process of doing that, which is not easy, but I presume it's doable. There is a way to do it.
I've never seen anyone have to do it.
I just know that there is something in the law that allows that.
no conditions coming forward? We're all looking at Linda.
Technical question, sir, the city has a master plan that, for sustainability, that has encouraged increased density through reform of zoning. And the intent was to increase density in the more downtown sections of the city, Northampton and Florence, and to reduce pressure on previously rural areas, and also particularly with affordable housing, to put affordable housing in environments that are accessible to city services, including transportation and so forth. Does this project comport with that?
The planning board did approve it, I believe. There is some zoning relief when a project includes affordable housing if the planning board agrees that it's in a location that makes sense.
We've seen this project and it was, I mean, the question of its location is, you know, we're back to on the one hand and on the other hand. Not trying to put all affordable housing in highly urban areas or all in the sort of same spots, but I think it's a reasonable question to ask about transportation. But it was approved.
I wasn't challenging whether it was approved.
Yeah, no, it was.
Or asking whether it actually comports with the guidelines, because it can be two different things.
Well, certainly that area out there isn't an area that had increased density associated with it. I mean, you know.
Right, but you see my point that as a layperson sort of looking at this, having the city say we want increased density, we don't want affordable housing out in the middle of the boondocks where you have to have a car in order to get anywhere where there's basically a food desert. But this is a nice project, so we're going to completely ignore the city's guidelines and we're going to do it anyway.
It never came out looking like that, but I hear what you're saying.
Okay.
I would offer that affordable housing isn't for a monolithic group of
yes.
people, and it's a broad range of incomes. So, you know, if you're dealing with the SRO project that happens doing, you've got people at 20% of AMI. But this is home ownership. It's people up to 100% of AMI. So I think you have to assess its suitability a little bit differently. It's people who are most likely working do not have the same need to access services. It wouldn't make any sense to put the SRO housing out in that location. It makes a lot more sense to put home ownership.
Mm-hmm.
It does. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Linda. That was helpful.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, it's helpful. I just there's nothing wrong with living downtown. In fact, this is a very, very expensive thing. So the notion that it's somehow a bad thing to concentrate affordable housing downtown, that may be true in some cities, but in Northampton, living downtown is kind of a nice thing. So I don't see, and it also comports with the city's goals of density and concentration of services and sustainability, and not having huge yards in the middle of downtown. But when we want to put something on the outside, then we say we use a different argument, which seems countervailing. We don't want to concentrate all the affordable housing downtown. And I say, well, why is it a bad thing?
Well, there's also a question of putting families of all kinds in schools, for instance, around the city rather than all in schools in one location. And so, you know, it's a balance in a lot of different ways.
Okay, so right now we're back to trying to hammer out some conditions for this. We have the 100% one, we have the 150,000 coming from open space. Is there any other conditions that we can see putting on this?
150,000. I think I'm defeated in trying to figure out something that would work to ensure that the housing is there where the money comes back, and maybe the restriction is what we're buying.
Chris, I can't help but notice you furiously writing. Are you just writing, or are you?
Letter mom.
Sorry, I'm on that. Okay, so we're good to go on that. Is that right? Hampshire County Courthouse, we have the one condition, which is the September 30th deadline for coming up with additional funds, correct? Any other conditions on that? Okay, Beaver Brook, the Broad Brook, and Lee's Conservation, Lee's Civic Association. Any conditions on that? The Connecticut River Greenway?
Yeah, one thought, and I appreciate the reaction to it. It has really two components to it. One is the creation of an accessible dock and apparatus right at the river's edge, and the other is paving. And I don't know, I guess I would like to say that the first project, the accessibility, needs to be given preference, and that needs to be spent, enough money needs to be spent to accomplish that, and then remainder to be used for paving. So that, because you can pave in stages and pave part, you know, if they run out of money or something. I would hate for the have a beautiful parking lot and not accomplish the accessibility issue. I would be quite upset.
So, is there a condition that, so you're saying the dock takes priority over the paving?
I think so, yeah.
Even I believe Wayne has made the point that paving enhances the accessibility.
I don't know that that has to be a choice, but.
You have to actually pave it. You can build an accessible dock, and then what you have is this island out there of accessibility that you can't get to, because you need the paving gets all of that access.
It has to do with a bump between A and B.
Imagine that you are using a walker or a wheelchair or whatever it is to get down there.
Yeah.
There's a I think it's about 4 inches of.
Well, my understanding was that stands to reason. I completely agree with what you just said. My understanding is that we're talking about also paving on
absolutely
big, much bigger, yeah, broader area. So the actual weight of water, of course, nobody wants to leave somebody unable to get over a curb spot. But I see that as handicap access. A lot of the requests, however, was for nothing that had to do with access, but for finish of putting a finish coat on a car driveway.
But if you don't put that finish coat on that car driveway, then we're not going to actually be able to put cars over there, whether it's for people who need additional access or not. The parking lot's going to deteriorate to such a point that the entire project becomes unusable. It needs a top coat to maintain it over time.
What are you proposing? Are you saying that we want to have a beautiful parking lot and access to our
dock?
I'm not saying we shouldn't pave it.
I do see the two pieces as going together. I think, what we'd love is to have a recreational area that is fully accessible and that we can use over many, many years. And, it would be an odd thing. The way that I see this project is it would be an odd thing. It would be great. We can do the paving that we need to make sure that we've gotten rid of the problems of access to this long, essentially it's a long driveway that gets you down to the boat dock, and then what we need to do to the dock itself. But if we don't also manage the area where people need to come and park, what we'll have is a wonderful long driveway with lots of access, but we can't put the cars there to get the people.
I've driven up there myself and parked, and I found entirely parkable and useful and functional. It's a base coat, and life one of us has that for a while before we can afford a finish coat. So it did a great job, and in the best of all worlds, and perhaps even under this grant, they can do it all. But I also know that the paving can be sometimes enormously expensive, depending on exact quantities or the contractor or that sort of thing. And I don't want to see a fabulous, beautiful, you know, million-dollar paving job and no access to the water.
You want the good job to come from the bottom and go to the top, and if it doesn't finish off at the top, tough on it. You don't want it to start at the top and go to the bottom and not be able to. Is that what you're saying?
You're the best representative of this discussion.
I don't want an element to start at the top. Because you know what? I know what you're saying, but I also want an element of it to start at the top. Because if you finish that bottom piece and you don't do at least some part of that,
of course,
you're never going to get there.
Of course. Although you can always level off and make the old and the new accessible, but what you're saying is just make sure that you don't just tar and leave the rest of it alone. That's really what you're asking.
Well, no, I think Dave's and I think my point's been made. The analogy I would use is when you do like a home improvement project, the landscaping is the thing that always gets funded last, and it's the $12,000 you didn't spend on the cost overruns on cabinets, and I would hate. Like Dave, I would hate to see the cost of the paving preclude doing the other portion of it. And I honestly believe what Julie's saying about, you know, but I also think that that's a 200 car parking lot.
Right, so you know? Fine, you'll
exactly.
So
if they run out of tar at 110 cars, I'm gonna sleep just fine.
So we put a lot of money into, I know that others have as well, we put a lot of money already into facility which currently gives great access to very capable and able-bodied rowers. And to me, putting more money into this thing is only justifiable if we are going to make it accessible to everybody in the community.
Can you come up with a specific condition, Dave?
Yeah, that this this is a two-part application that involves both accessible dock and paving, and put it best that we start at the damn bottom and work our way up, that the project the accessible dock and access to the accessible dock did include paving.
Be considered preeminent in its
funding, and that reserved parking be given a lower priority in funding.
This has already got matching money associated.
Correct. $90,000.
And is that matching money specified to something in particular? I can't remember anymore.
I don't know, Sarah.
It was structured the same as this application was. So it was the whole project.
Maybe
the whole
make a choice. Maybe adequate to fund everything.
So I would say make the dock accessible, match the elevations, and anything else left over, take care of it.
Yeah, good.
Right? But match the elevations.
Yeah, yeah. Sure, of course.
I would match the elevation first, actually.
Well, that's by paving it down and coming back up, because that's the only way you get the ADA. The only way you get the ADA approval process.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That was what I was trying to get at in the letter I sent to planning.
Right.
And I didn't really get an answer
that
reflected the question, so I'm afraid I didn't phrase it very well. But that was really what I wanted to, which is make it, do the grading, do the dock, and then. Mm-hmm.
Sarah, is there a language that you come up with?
Is that something we want in the council order or something in the funding agreement?
Does it matter?
No, not really.
I mean, I'm comfortable with it just being guidance. It doesn't have to be necessarily formal order.
I'm just wondering if it'll be more acceptable to council if it's clear that the accessibility has to be funded.
Be in that result,
Just as because we all kind of swallow hard at the notion of paying for paving.
Yes.
But paving as it enhances accessibility is much more tolerable for us. Should we let you work on the language there for a moment?
Sure.
Okay. So let's see. The Conscom, we established the condition on that, which is the under $10,000 for hard costs. Historic building, Smith Charities, any conditions on that? We have changed, they've changed.
I have a question for the committee, I have no idea of the answer. What should we, do we want to receive a copy of the survey? Is that prying too much? Is that their bailiwick?
No, that's pretty standard.
Sorry?
I wouldn't trust that they actually had it done unless they sent me a copy of it.
Okay.
I wouldn't even pay the invoice.
Is that a condition or is that?
We could just put that in the contract.
Yeah, that they will come, thank you, Dan. Anything else on the Smith Charities? The Broadbrook to Beaverbrook acquisition? No. And the Mineral Hills? I would put the condition that we will only accept any of these open space if Linda contributes.
How much?
That's.
I thought 2,000 to each people.
Jack, is that enough for a Jack?
He's pretty smart, Dan, to get that.
Three, oh, Jack is now contributing the matching. Okay, so, let's see. Sarah, refresh my memory on how we can do this. Can we vote this as a package? Are we allowed to do that or do we go one by one?
You might want to go one by one just to have a chance to look at the
conditions.
Well, there's always, but there's in them, there's always something in one of the resolutions that causes someone to vote against it, which makes it look not unanimous, so it's at the pleasure of the committee, I would say.
Okay, so how do we want to do this? Do we want to vote proposal by proposal or do we want to vote as a package deal?
Well, let's try package, and if there's opposition if it doesn't pass, then we'll break it in.
Okay. Does that sound okay? Lump this all together as a package?
At 817 or whatever it is?
870,640, I believe.
I move that we...
Well, hold on. Let's just make sure we know what the conditions are. I think we're back to the... Connecticut River Greenway one. Sarah, did you were you able to?
It doesn't sound pretty good. I just threw in a whereas clause. CPA funds will be used first for pier accessibility and paving to match accessible sidewalk elevations, and then to complete paving on the rest of the site.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great. Good. That's who needs pretty. That is functional and wonderful.
That includes providing equipment for the. Successful dock, right? And then,
it's all part of it.
Yeah.
It's all part of it. Okay, so we're looking at this as a package deal, or a proposal totaling $870,640 with the conditions that we have talked about.
So moved.
Someone make a proposal on that rather than so moved?
I make a proposal that we approve number of projects, summary projects that come with a total of $817,000 and change. As a group approval.
Second.
Any further discussion? And we're comfortable with the conditions as laid out? Okay, all those in favor? All those opposed? Hooray for us! Yay!
So that leaves us with
nothing.
I'm going to change.
But really, truly, don't sweat it because this group can spend hours talking about $6,000. So we're good for the spring, no matter how much money.
In fact, with less money.
In fact, if we had $50, it still would last all spring.
Sarah, what else do you need from us?
We should go through the council resolutions, just because that's me taking the committee's wishes to council, and these will be used to govern the projects going forward.
Okay.
Always add extra conditions to the grant agreements. That's not a problem.
Okay.
It doesn't make it any less binding, but these are the things we want everybody to know.
Can we do this now?
Sure.
Can you put it up on the
sure
things for us to see?
Still, sorry.
Sounds like someone's really
good. It doesn't do that on my computer.
No, it's the Rolling Stones.
That's funny, terrible.
What is that?
I can't remember, but it's the Rolling Stones.
I thought it was Looney Tunes.
You're driving me crazy now. It's opening the, you know, they have those shows where they give you the first.
Yeah, I can name that tune in three bars. Yeah, it is. No, it's the Rolling Stones, and I'm gonna come up with it. But
well, please do. It's gonna get me away for the next 6 weeks.
Okay.
So we'll take these one by one.
Sure.
Can you do it on other TVs too? Is that possible?
Sure.
I mean, if everyone's gonna look at this, no, never mind. I'll just turn around.
Do you want me to read them out loud, or does everybody want to read them up there? Ooh.
So we got what we're doing. We're looking at the whereases and seeing if we need to add any more whereases.
So is you're saying habitat improvements in an attempt to avoid yet another discussion about invasives and treatment of invasives?
Not intentionally, but maybe subconsciously.
Well done.
That's true. For those of you that don't know that are new.
It is primarily brush hogging, though. That's their main focus.
For those of you that don't know, we funded a number of different projects with BBC that go specifically toward the removal of invasive species, particularly Phragmites but other stuff as well, and explicitly using herbicides as a way to manage those. And where there's a city council member who's convinced that herbicides are not the way to manage, particularly the use of rodeo in wetlands, and has voted against those proposals every single time, and will probably continue to do so, although to my knowledge has never come up with an alternative other than something that doesn't work, and that's, I'm editorializing somewhat.
For the sake of anyone who's unfamiliar with it, this is not broadcast herbicide, this
right.
is daubing
oh, yeah.
the cuts.
Yeah, it's catching, yeah.
Oh,
catching.
Oh, yeah.
We didn't go over the plant.
By hand,
sure.
daubing, very, very careful,
yes.
not broadcast, not spray.
With incredible success. Mm-hmm. Okay. That was editorializing. Okay, so are we good with the whereases for the Beaverbrook, Broadbrook? Anything else to add? Good to go?
Yep.
Morgan.
All right, next.
Okay. And I'll put in the proper
numbers.
I don't have them. Yeah. And I'll add unanimous. We can still go through these. So this is the Broadbrook connector.
More with small amount of grants than almost any other group in the city. They've been wonderful.
They really are amazing.
Yeah.
Who?
The Broadbrook Coalition.
Oh, that's unbelievable. Yeah.
I mean, they get so much money out of 16. There's so much stuff out of $16,000.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, and the dock at not the dock, the walkway at Fitzgerald Lake was finished yesterday.
Oh,
if anybody wants to go visit.
Cool.
Oh, that's great. So this is 18-acre additional. Any other warehouses? Sorry, you do a good job with making all this stuff sound so wonderful. Anything else?
So we didn't actually discuss the request that there be no hunting. Isn't this the parcel that Broadbrook wanted no hunting and wanted to see the creation of a
parking area.
Yeah. Needs a space after the second floor. And all that green stuff will disappear.
Are you suggesting that?
No, I guess I'm not. I'm just remembering.
Sarah, what did you say about hunting? There was some.
Broadbrook Coalition was opposed to it. Mm-hmm.
Opposed to the hunting or restriction?
Opposed to hunting and wanted a restriction. Hunting is currently prohibited at all conservation areas except a few that were done with careful thought. And staff's opinion was that to leave it open just because conditions might change in the future. We might have a deer infestation or something like that. But I can't imagine that hunting would be allowed on this parcel.
Okay.
and the parking lot we're good with not dealing with? Or Linda, do you want it in there that a parking lot will be? No?
I don't. I just wanted to remind people we haven't actually talked about it. If anybody else particularly cares.
So anything else on this? Okay, next.
This is Bird's Paw. And it started out as an open space resolution, but then morphed into an affordable housing resolution.
Could be a school master, is there an apostrophe after birth?
Yes.
Is it possessive?
Yes.
Okay.
It was a guy named Bird that had a barn, so it is his barn.
So you want some reference to the what's the housing plan that the housing partnership did?
Is it in the proposal, Linda? Is it in the proposal?
No, I don't think so.
Anything else on this?
Well, I think it should, I mean, I think there should be some reference to it and some consistency.
In the...
Reference to the housing needs assessment.
I could just highlight it and make sure it's the right name.
Yeah.
I could go online and do it, but I can't do this and online at the same time.
Can we just say the project whereas the project meets many of the community housing criteria? Something as vague as that, Linda?
Yeah, I think if you would substitute the right reference
okay. When
you find it.
Anything else?
Although that no longer is, you're gonna have to add something about affordable housing in that same paragraph.
Anything else? Oh, okay, next.
Conservation fund. So with the requirement for a way to return with the 20,000, that's never been in a council order, so I didn't put it in here, but we could. It's generally just always been in the grant agreement.
10,000.
10. Well, it was 20 previously, so that wasn't. So we can add the 10 to that for you.
Do you think it belongs in this?
I would say all land purchases will be reviewed and approved by the Conservation Commission. Oh, Conservation Commission, okay, thank you.
The other guys.
The other guys.
So no need to put in the $10,000 in this?
I wouldn't think so.
Okay.
That's our issue. That's a council issue.
Anything else on this? Good to go?
Right, so the courthouse restoration. For this one, I did include that CPA funds will only be used as a match for state capital bond bill funds, but I didn't include the specifics about the timing. That seemed like a contract specification.
Isn't it capital with an A?
It is.
Is region? capitalized?
No.
So it's next paragraph, but now therefore references the historic curtain.
No, that won't do. Maybe they have a curtain.
I read a couple of nice editorials about that.
Yes.
Okay, anything else on this? No? Good? Next.
What does the city council actually see? So I could go to the city council meeting.
So they read these out loud.
But just did I see any of the applications?
No.
I do a cover letter that's about 2 pages that gives a synopsis of everything and provide the link. I don't know that any of the councilors actually can go to the link and read the applications.
They have great confidence in us. We're satisfied with the next to last whereas? David, did you go on that?
Yeah.
Anything else? All right, we're almost there. Next.
Two more.
So what's this one?
This is the Glendale Road number 66 acquisition.
No. No, I don't think you did.
But you voted for the package of them.
Okay, got it.
If we wanted to use those previous votes, we could do that too.
No, it's fine.
Is there a reason to describe land that's reserved for hiking and exploring as a passive recreation? I'm just curious. Maybe is there a regulatory requirement that you have to do this?
We don't have to. It's specific to the land grant, although the state just realized that they never actually defined what passive recreation is. So we're working really hard to come up with what exactly what that means.
Yeah.
But no, we don't have to. It just, I guess, makes it clear it's not going to be a ball field or something like that.
It's not going to have motorcycles.
Oh, okay. Absolutely. Well, to me, that's more passive than hunting.
Well, the whole issue of horses and bicycles and all become, is that passive?
Hey, you step back from the bicycle, too.
Yeah. Well, remember the horses with some of the Broadbrook stuff was. Was a huge issue at this drove. Good to go on this. Last one. Oh yeah.
Smith Charities.
I should. So for the votes for the previous ones, I'll go back and change it if it wasn't unanimous. There were two that weren't.
There were two that weren't.
So I can address that.
However, we did vote as a package deal unanimously, so I'm not sure how we address that. The only two that weren't unanimous was the Mineral Hills and the Smith Charities, correct?
Yes.
That was just a shopping cart vote.
That was just a shopping cart vote.
As a group,
I think we keep it as unanimous. Yeah. Okay, last one is Smith.
We're spinning stones tunes all night.
Please email me, Chris, if
You betcha.
Call me anytime.
Tweet it.
I'm sure it's on YouTube somewhere.
Okay, here we are, Smith.
I'm gonna hear it on the radio in 3 days, you know.
We're back to the historic curtain. It won't leave. The historic curtain.
They just called their building the Smith Charities Building. I couldn't, is that correct? I couldn't find any other reference to it.
Smith Charities Building, yeah.
Preservation survey.
Historic study?
Okay. Also, we're gonna ask for a copy of it.
That's not a whereas. That's not a whereas. That's just.
We can put that in the contract.
I was down and now therefore it be ordered.
Comes in the contract, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, so I won't pay them.
I mean, we're gonna spend the money, I figured it needs to be a public document, they're out there after.
Absolutely, and we do have a copy of the fairgrounds grandstand study.
Yeah, no, but I don't want them to spend the money on the survey and then bury it.
No.
All right, good to go on that. So Sarah, do we need to meet in 2 weeks?
We don't have to.
You will have nothing to.
At some point, we will have to meet to approve the contract, but in next week, we won't even have gone to council yet, so that's why I'm doing that.
So we'd wait until January?
Yes, we'll wait until January.
Well, at this point, what we've done in the past is set up our spring schedule at this last December, or not December, November meeting. The question we'll have to deal with is, are we gonna, you know, what are we gonna do about this spring? And how are we gonna?
We have $70,000 available.
70?
Right, but isn't some of that earmarked toward historic preservation?
Yes.
How much of that is earmarked?
$34,000, so half of it.
So 34 to historic preservation, 36 to anything else.
For some little towns, that's similar to what their average, you know, half year budget is. So
oh, yeah.
We should still take it seriously, I guess,
and
meet. But we can, why don't we set a normal schedule and then waive certain meetings if we don't do them.
That sounds good. Can we do that now, Sarah? Or do you want to? Do you have that?
I don't have it prepared.
You send it out?
Yeah. Generally, I use the one from the previous year and adjust the date so that they make sense.
Yes.
At least as a starting.
Well, the other thing is that we may get proposals that we want to only partially fund, so that we wouldn't fully fund anyhow, but we want to support them and move forward. So.
And we may always have grants that from previous years that haven't used all their money, although I tried to get as much as we could from the previous round.
Okay, so Sarah, you will send that out to us.
Yeah.
In the next few weeks, perhaps before the craziness of the middle of December
sure.
begins, we'll get back to you.
And we won't need to get our approval on those parcels before we meet in January. That'll be sufficient time.
Good point.
Yeah, that should be fine. I think he's aiming for a June closing, so that should be fine.
Is there any other business not foreseen when agenda was not written?
Woo! I'm sorry, it sounded very Don Rumsfeldian.
Well, we should pat ourselves on our back, and the neighbor's back with their permission. This was, I think, really difficult, and we managed to get through it with grace and dignity, and no one screaming at each other.
Bon homie.
So that's not a bad thing. Yeah. So hooray for us. Golly.
Right on cue.
Okay. It just keeps saying document not saved and making the Twain.
I don't think it's the Rolling Stones.
You're going to hate yourself when I find it.
Well, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second, all in favor, yes. Happy holidays.
Yes.